Well, hey everybody, this video is going to be covering section 11.1 in our book about empirical and theoretical probabilities. And just a quick note before we get started, be ready to hit pause on this video whenever you need to. I edit these things down so that they go pretty fast. Okay, our first note is that the probability of any event occurring is given as a number between 0 and 1. For example, the probability of some particular event might be 0.138. What that corresponds to is a 13.8% chance of that event occurring. If the probability of an event occurring is zero, that means that there's a 0% chance that that is going to occur, which means that that event is impossible. If the probability of an event occurring is one, that refers to a 100% chance, and that means that that event has to happen. Our next note is that if the probability of an event occurring is, say, for example, 0.3, then the probability of the event not occurring is 0.7. I think that this fact makes more sense if we consider that this 0.3 means a 30% chance of happening. Then the probability that that thing does not happen is 70%, which is given by a 0.7 probability. To say this a little bit more mathematically, the probability of an event occurring plus the probability that it doesn't occur has to add up to 1. To write that out with the notation of this section, what we would say is that the probability of event A plus the probability of A not happening has to add up to 1. There is a 100% chance that either an event will happen or it won't happen. Along the same line of logic, if we want to get a little bit more general with this, what we can say is that the sum of all of the probabilities of all of the possible outcomes of some event, which we'll call, I guess, an experiment, that sum has to be 1. All this really says is that something has to happen. There's a 100% chance that some outcome of this experiment will happen. Let's take the example of a coin flip. The two possible outcomes of a coin flip are heads and tails. The probability that you're going to flip a heads is typically 1/2 if it's a fair coin, and the probability that you're going to flip a tails is also 1/2. Those are the only two possible outcomes of this experiment, which we're calling a coin flip, so the sum of those two outcomes must be 1. And in this case, you can tell that that is true. We would write that as the probability of getting heads plus the probability of getting tails equals 1. So what we just calculated there was actually our first theoretical probability. Theoretical probability can also be called classical probability. Typically, we think of it as like a mathematical probability that something is going to happen. We write the theoretical probability of an event called E as P of E, just like this, and we can calculate it using this formula. It is the number of outcomes in which this event E happens divided by the total number of possible outcomes. So for this coin flip, if we're just flipping this coin once, the number of outcomes in which heads happens was just 1, and the total number of possible outcomes was 2. You can either get heads or tails. So in this case, the probability of getting heads turned out to be 1 divided by 2. Let's look at another example. One card is randomly selected from a 52-card deck. What is the probability of drawing a 7? So we want to calculate the probability of the event drawing a 7. So you're drawing this card, and the total number of possible outcomes for what this card could be is 52. And how many 7s are in the deck? How many different outcomes would give you a 7? Well, I believe there are 4 7s in a deck. We could type that 4 over 52 into our calculator. That could give us a decimal of approximately 0.077, which refers to about a 7.7% chance that that event occurs. And just to show you, if you wanted to write this as a reduced fraction, what you could do is you could click this math button here on your calculator, then you could just hit enter. That asks the calculator to turn this decimal into a fraction. If you hit enter, it gives you the reduced fraction of 1/13th, or we can say we have a 1 out of 13 chance of drawing a 7. Let's look at another example. We have a cooler that contains 4 types of soda. There are 34 cans of cola, 45 cans of orange soda, 15 cans of ginger ale, and 6 root beers. If one can is randomly selected, determine the probability that, and then we can ask several questions. Let's first determine the probability that ginger ale is selected. We would write that as the probability of ginger ale. The total number of ginger ale cans in the cooler is 15, so there are 15 possible outcomes where we select ginger ale. How many total outcomes are there? Well, that depends on how many cans are in the cooler. We have to add up the total number of cans in the cooler. It looks to me like there are 100 total cans in the cooler, meaning that our probability of selecting ginger ale is 15 over 100. That gives us 0.15, or a 15% chance of drawing a ginger ale. We could also ask, what is the probability of selecting a cola or an orange? Well, going back up to our list here, it looks like there are 34 possible colas and there are 45 possible orange sodas. So the number of ways to get a cola or an orange soda is the sum of those two possibilities. We're going to divide those possibilities by the total number of possible drinks, which is 100, and we're getting 79 over 100, or a probability of 0.79. Okay, last question on this problem. What is the probability of selecting a cola and an orange soda? soda? Well, in this example, we are just selecting one soda. So it's not possible to get both a cola and an orange from just one selection. So that probability is just going to be zero. In the future, we might draw two sodas from this cooler and ask the question, what is the probability of getting a cola and an orange? But for now, we're going to leave it right there. Because we next want to talk about empirical probabilities. Now, empirical probabilities, we can just think of as experimental probabilities. We actually run an experiment and ask the question, what is the probability of some event happening? An example here might be a coin is actually flipped 10 times, and maybe 6 of them landed as heads. In this experiment, the probability that the coin lands as a heads is 6 heads out of 10 possible coin flips, or 0.6. And you'll notice that this differs from our theoretical probability. And that's totally okay, that's gonna happen sometimes. We only flipped this coin 10 times, which is a pretty small number of coin flips. So while we might expect to get 5 heads, or 1/2 heads, it's not unusual that that didn't exactly happen. However, we do have this law of large numbers, which says that in the long run, let's say we flip this coin 1,000,000 times, this empirical probability, or this experimental probability, is going to get closer and closer to our theoretical probability of 0.5. Okay, so in other words, if we want our experiments to be better, we should just run those experiments more times. Okay, let's do one more example of an empirical probability. Here we had a survey where we asked people what their favorite pet was, and we got these responses. 51 people said dog, 35 said cat, and so on. And we want to find the probability that a randomly selected person's favorite pet is a cat. So I'm going to write this as the probability of cat. And given our data, the number of people that chose cat was 35. And to find our empirical probability, we have to divide by the total number of people surveyed here. So if we add all these numbers up, I'm getting that there were 91 people surveyed. So the probability that a randomly selected person is going to choose cat based on this data is 35 divided by 91, which is approximately 0.385 or a 38.5% chance. Okay, I think that that's going to do it for this section. I'll see you in the next one.